Hare Krishna. That's this. Okay, Tirumala, I got your cover. Thank you. Just got it. Om Gana Timirandasya Ginanana Salakaya Shakshuram Miritam Yena Tasmai Si Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhistam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So I'm happy to see you all. I'm also happy to see Sarva Prama Prabhu here. My obeisances. Oh, glorious to Srila Prabhupada. And I think, you know, somehow or other he remembers me with kindness, but what can I say, you know, like when someone falls unconscious off the ground, what am I supposed to do? Turn around and walk away or something? You know, I mean, it was kind of natural that he fell unconscious in Vrindavan in front of Krishna and Balaram one time, and somehow or other. Yeah. Anyway, so the devotees carried him and I went also. To see that he was all right. we can't hear you, but if you unmute, if you can, you're welcome. They don't.
No, please try now.
Yeah.
Okay, I clicked it. I think it's unlocked. It's open, unmuted now.
Yes, you are unmuted. So
Maharaj, you're like Vaisheshika. Vaisheshika refuses to admit his heroic standard. On page 440 of his book called Family Business, he describes something that happened between the two of us out at O'Hare, and he completely eliminates how heroic he was. And you're doing the same thing. Because you're saying only once, but the way it happened was I was in very bad health. I fell down right next to you. I fainted. I passed out. And you immediately picked me up. And I said, thank you. And then I passed out again. So twice you had to save me. And the second time, my memory is that maybe a few other people may have tagged along, but you were the one that picked me up and heroically carried me to the guest, lobby in the guest house. And then I was just telling one of your disciples earlier today that not only did you rescue me heroically, but then, Prabhu, you stayed with me for half an hour. You didn't have to do that. You made sure that I was okay. I'm just some nobody nowhere. I didn't even have my impressive beard back. Now I'm working on having an impressive beard. Then I didn't even have a beard going for me. You rescued me and saved me. I'm eternally grateful. I'm eternally grateful to you.
You can't see that.
And one last thing. I'm encouraged by your wonderful disciple. I said to her that her grandfather guru, which is Jayadvaita Swami, he's my Dvartma Darshaka Prabhu, because I stumbled into the middle of New York, that big Times Square, and all the devotees were chanting and everything, and I was just a stumbling, bizarre, hippie with nothing going for me. and I stumbled along at the end of the line of the Harinam party, and the last person turned around and he beamed this gigantic, powerful smile at me, and it was Jai Advaita Maharaj. And he totally captured my heart. No question that I could be anything but at least trying to be a devotee from that moment on. So I thank you.
Anyway, thank you for everything, really.
Now I mute myself. Thank you very much for letting me speak.
It was short and what shall I say, very rich, you know. We all laughed, and it's very nice. Yeah, we're a family. I mean, and I'm glad about that, you know. Anyway, Sarvapramabhu, I'm looking forward to meeting you again in person. And okay, I'm going to put it back on multiple screens. Let me just quickly look how many are already here. There are 100 people here now, maybe some more later. We remember, first of all, Srila Prabhupada. My Krishna consciousness was somehow or other came to me in my life in the Netherlands to begin with some encounters. But then I went to India and absorbed more of India. And then as I came back, I lived in a macrobiotic community. There was a house and everyone was macrobiotic, and macrobiotic is sort of what is vegan today. I could live in that house for free, and I was vegetarian actually. I wasn't really a macrobiotic, to be honest. But if I gave a dairy, I could live there for free, although I admit I sometimes smuggled cheese under my coat in the house because I'm Dutch. It's hard to live without cheese. Yeah, what to do? So it was very nice. It was a nice group of people. Everyone was vegetarian. And there was one boy who worked in the forestry department. And in the day, he was cleaning the forest as a job. And then he would also pick some herbs from the forest, bring them back to us, and he'd cook them at night with rice. And then that's what we would eat with chopsticks. Right? So it was really healthy, we thought. Pure herbs from the forest and rice. And brown rice, of course, you know. And then that boy, he would take cold showers in the winter and everything. And he was into Tai Chi. And I was reading lots of philosophical books. So both him and me, we were interested in spiritual things. He was teaching me a little bit of Tai Chi and I was teaching in the Tibetan Book of the Dead. And then, and then one day he just disappeared off the planet completely. And it was a big shock. He just disappeared. And I found out then that he had disappeared into a Hare Krishna temple. So I decided to go on a mission, possibly to save him and at least check it out, what was going on. But he was determined to stay there. And he told me, I was always on the way to India. So I had a ticket to India in my pocket. And he told me, next time you go to India, you have to go to Vrindavan. And I did. I did. And that made all the difference in my life. What shall I say? In Vrindavan, everything is dedicated to Krishna. It's first of all the devotees in Vrindavan that make Vrindavan visible to us. Because the devotees in Vrindavan, they're everywhere just worshiping. They have their temples, their shrines, they are making parikramas, they are chanting in the night. Even the animals are devotees. The peacocks would all chant at 3 a.m. and waves of peacocks screaming would go, would resound. It was very, very nice. At that time, when I entered into the temple, it was 6:45 at night. And all these devotees started to bow down to a plant. And I was like, whoa, here we go. Now we're gonna worship a plant. Woo-hoo. Next, the temple doors opened and there was this little albino pujari who came out and blew a conch shell. And that looked so otherworldly that, like, at that point, I thought, this must be the spiritual world. Then I saw the deities and they were just stunning, overwhelmingly beautiful, to a point where it just shocked me and where I just, like, where my hair stood on end for a moment. And so I was very overwhelmed by Krishna, Krishna's presence in Krishna's world. But then I also, after not too much time, began to see how everything in Vrindavan was connected with Srila Prabhupada. At least the whole Krishna Balaram Mandir. His house was there. And in the winter, we would chant japa. And there was, his samadhi was just there. And it wasn't, was only a little shed at the time. It was Prabhupada's presence in Vrindavan was felt everywhere. He had touched every aspect of that project so much. Everything reminded of him. And I realized one thing. Prabhupada is more present here, even than Krishna. And from that, I understood something about this movement. And I understood it's like the connection with Prabhupada must be established first and foremost. Then we'll make the connection with Krishna. That was very, very clear. And without that connection with Prabhupada, we cannot make that connection with Krishna. Never in the same way, never to the same depth. That was so clear, actually, very much from the beginning. So from all that time that I spent in Vrindavan, I had one good fortune, and that was that I saw Krishna consciousness in its natural form. Because, in the Western world, there's Krishna consciousness, but it is it's kind of, what shall I say, there's a building, oftentimes a small one, and that's it, you know. And then devotees in their houses, whatever Krishna consciousness you'll find there, and in between, oceans of Maya. Mm-hmm. And so it's just little islands in an ocean, really. And in Vrindavan, it's just an ocean of Krishna everywhere. Everything is Krishna, you know what I mean? The whole town is just Krishna. And then wherever you go, you find out more and more about Krishna. You find so many places related to Krishna, so many pastimes come out. I mean, it's like, yeah, you can look at Vrindavan through so many lenses. You can go to Vrindavan and follow in the footsteps of the Goswamis. And you can find all the places that relate to the history of the Goswamis. We've gone with our disciples, you know, with groups of our disciples, we've done that, right? We went to the places related to the Goswamis. Then we also traveled to Jaipur and other places to meet the deities that they established, just to deepen our relationship with the Goswamis, with the six Goswamis. But of course, there are many other amazing Vaishnavas who have who've left some heritage in Vrindavan, who've left temples, who have left, as many books have been written. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu has been written at Ter Kadamba in Vrindavan. So I really like to think of Vrindavan through these different lenses. First of all, Prabhupada, and to be there in Prabhupada's house, with all the paintings on the wall that were there at the time, and that have been, now they've been restored. And these paintings, they tell something. Just above Prabhupada's head, Radha and Krishna are there being worshipped by the Astasakhi under a desire tree, and the roots of that desire tree. There are jewels under the roots of that desire tree. Radha and Krishna seated on a golden throne. And we can read this in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. We see how Krishna and Balaram are returning home in the evening from the forest. And we can see. So yes, to me that is a place of very concentrated Krishna consciousness. Because not only was this the place where Prabhupada was, or even the place where Prabhupada left this world, but this was the place that Prabhupada's house reflects Prabhupada's mood. Prabhupada would not have tolerated some bogus painting. He would not have tolerated it. If there was Rasa Bas, if it was not bona fide, it would not have stayed there. So the fact that it's on the wall and the Prabhupada is there, it means something. Yeah? And yes, I used to chant my japa in front of that Krishna Balaram painting and step up and down, because I was a little tired in the morning, so I had to move. So I'd walk like, I'd have about 1.5 meter until the next devotee, sort of like 2 steps forward, 2 steps backward, just looking at that painting and chanting. It's like, it's almost, as if I stepped in the painting. I'm writing a novel nowadays, and in my novel, I am actually stepping in the painting with a few people. We're doing it. We're in there. So when my novel comes out, then you can read it, and I will surely send a copy to Sarvaprama Prabhu, since he's here now, and start talking about my novel. But I have to finish it first, what to do. So that world of Krishna is not just something imaginary. When Srila Prabhupada refers to paintings as the windows of the spiritual world, yes, then why not climb through the window? Why not have a peek? Of course, I'm just an intruder. When it comes to the world of Krishna, I'm an intruder in one sense, an outsider at least. But in the other sense, we are also authorized, right? Because we're authorized by this parampara. And because of this parampara, we are authorized to approach Krishna, even although we are from this age of Kali. Even although we have all this weakness, even although we are lazy, less intelligent, and so on, still, the special mercy is there in our life. So we trust in Krishna, and Krishna somehow or other looks after us, and everything goes on in this way. So that time in Vrindavan has kind of given me this strong focus on Srila Prabhupada, and makes me want to be someone who dedicates his life to pleasing Srila Prabhupada and doing what doing what was important to him. I'd like to embrace that. Whatever was important to Prabhupada, let that be important to me. And otherwise, what else is important? Nothing really. Prabhupada is our criteria of deciding what's important, what's not important. Very simple. And it is, otherwise so many things may address itself, and some of these things may be necessary, but it may not be important. So many things need to be done. Material world, I have to do something, guys. Everyone needs to make choices: where to live, how to make money, how to function. Something.
Recording in progress.
That's going to cause an echo in the room. You have to have earphones if you want to do that. You can do it. You have to put your earphones. Someone in the room just turned on a second phone and.
Oh my God.
Go out otherwise and just sort it out outside. Okay. Yeah. Because that's what happens. They start to echo and then it gets worse and worse. And then you get feedback. And then, technology. Oh. Anyhow. Back to Krishna. And so there are many things in this world we have to deal with. It's like technology, for example. How can you not deal with technology in this modern world? It's impossible. I guess you know, if you go in traditional Rajasthan, people had long turbans, right? Big turbans, and they were multi-purpose. Certainly, the turbans were there to keep the sun off a person's head, right? Because that Rajasthan sun is quite intense. But another advantage of the big turban was that they could take it off and use it to lower a water bag, right, into the well and pull up some water. Yeah. So it could also function as a rope in emergency, which, you know, in a place like Rajasthan, water is just, it's amazing. When you go into the desert, right? I have been in the desert many times in Rajasthan to buy stone from the mines for Srila Prabhupada's Samadhi in Mayapur. And then we thought, this time we've got enough water. Then we were in the desert, and then after an hour or so, we had to say, whoa, that water is going really fast. We have to start rationing it. Right? And then again, you know, somehow or other, make it to the end of the day. So you can see that the traditional culture of Rajasthan was, was very practical. There were emergency arrangements for water. But, you know, this is just a nice, colorful detail, how the colorful turban can also be used as a robe to get water. And obviously, water can be crucial in Rajasthan. But that's not the glory of Rajasthan. The glory of Rajasthan is clearly their worship of Krishna, that they're devotees of Krishna. That makes Rajasthan so special. Well, that everywhere you'll find temples of Krishna in Rajasthan and devotees of Krishna. It's the tradition, it's the culture. Just like the Marwaris, they are traditional devotees of Krishna. What can I say? Gujaratis also. Of course, yes, it's sometimes a little watered down here and there. That's also going on. But still, it's in the culture. Yes. So, how nice. And that is the essence. That is the essence. So we, in the same way, we come from, we have our own cultures. And we all come from different times. Just like Sarvapalma Prabhu was speaking about being there on Times Square. And I was on Dam Square in Amsterdam, which is the central square. And there, young people were looking for something else and were ready to live very simple and renounced. The hippie phenomena was something which had its roots in people who felt no satisfaction in the modern materialistic way of life, who were looking for a different approach to life, an alternative consciousness. For many, the hippie movement was a means, it was not the goal. For some, the hippie movement was the goal. But many, through that hippie movement, right, went deeper into spiritual life because it was not their goal. But they wanted something else than mainstream society, than to be a mainstream consumer and part of this production and consumption society. Yes. Anyway, in the process of that, there was a lot of people who lived in very simple conditions. I lived, for example, for 3/4 of a year, something like that, in a house with only half a roof. Yeah. I lived on the side where there was a roof. But it was raining in the back. Yeah, it was gushing down. I mean, when it rained, you could just take your shower right there in the room next door. Wasn't it that at one point I had a friend from Morocco who lived in a tent, quite a large tent, but in the room next door. Anyway, what shall I say? They were different days, and there was no electricity, only candles. Yes, and the shower was across the road. It was a restaurant, a vegetarian restaurant, so I could take a shower there, and there was rainwater for the toilet, so that was okay. It was all right for a while. Had a nice room, actually. And it was all about minimizing needs. It was for free. Now one might say that this was one might look upon this as negative, as undesirable elements in society. But we didn't see it like that. We just saw that we are looking for a way to get out of an undesirable society. And it was very idealistic. It was really like, didn't want to be part of this crazy world. This world has gone out of control. This world is just it's become like a big machine that just forces everyone to go along instead of we should go back to the real roots of life. So we were seekers for the real roots of life. Some thought back to the earth, right? So many of my friends left the city and went living on the country. And they were eating veggies grown from their garden, some brown rice was coming from the shop, and they were having miso soup and all these kind of things. What shall I say? They believed in that. They believed in what they were doing. They're very idealistic people. People who really said, no, we're not going to be part of this. We're going to be part of going to have a different world. I myself, I never was so earthly. And I've never had a desire to put my hands in the earth. It hasn't, I've always been more the stars, It's like if you go, the ground has always been like, it's like, at the same time, I'm very practical. I'm very kind of a person who deals with the earth, but the stars, the other worlds, or what is beyond the stars, what was interesting me. I was looking at like, what is behind it all? That's what I wanted to know. What is behind this world? Not like, what is a better path in this world? But I wanted to know what is behind this world. That is what interested me. For that I traveled, for that I read, for that I made music, for that I sang, for that I lived in a house with half a roof, for that I did all these things. I wanted to know what was behind this world. And in the process of that, I had decided that I would try and not be part of it as little as possible. Okay, so that was the way I was filling in the hippie lifestyle. There were others who were playing with kaleidoscopes and just taking certain chemicals and were looking for hours at the changing colors. But that never appealed to me. You know, I felt that's playing. I did that also, Sarvapalma. I mean, once I was with someone with a beard just like yours, but it was red. It had a red beard. And by the influence of the mystical things that I took, I let green hair grow out of his nose, mixing with the red beard. And I laughed and laughed for a long time. But that was, playing with the world of the mind, like a child. No, I could see that's not interesting. No. I could see that my generation experimented with some drugs. I cannot say that I stayed behind, because I didn't want to stay behind, because I wanted to be part of my generation. I felt if I don't go along with this, then I will be cut off from all the other young people around me. That would not be good. So I did try, but and played with it, but I could see this is not what I'm looking for. I'm not here to play now with this. If I wind up playing with these things, it's the same, like others playing with their toys, their machines, their houses, their money. No, I'm not interested in the toys of this world. I realized it. So I left that, I moved on. And I said, it has to be something more substantial. What is behind all of this? So that brought me gradually to Krishna consciousness. And and of course, now we know so much. Now we know it's Krishna who is behind it. Of course, who is Krishna? That is the next question. All right. Yes, lotus eyes, lotus mouth, lotus face, lotus navel, lotus hand, lotus feet. Yes, blazes flutes. Yes, Krishna. So many descriptions of Krishna, but so many pastimes of Krishna, so many qualities of Krishna. But do we know Krishna? Who's behind all of this? To what degree? To what degree do we know Krishna? So now I want to really know Krishna, not just to a degree, to an extent, not just spending my time hearing. Of course, you know, Prabhupada would often give the example of the iron in the fire. Yes, it's one favorite example. You try to give someone water in your car. hypocrisy on the continent. So Prabhupada would often give the example of iron in the fire. So this morning I was listening to a lecture, and Srila Prabhupada was explaining how this iron is in the fire of regular hearing and chanting. And then over time, it gets red hot. Prabhupada said, therefore, over time, just by hearing and chanting, the natural Krishna consciousness will awaken. There's no doubt about it. And it will get red hot and start to act like fire. It will bring us into that transcendental dimension. So that's what I always wanted, to connect with Krishna. I always wondered what is behind this world. So many things were there, you know. In 1963, I was 10 years old. Yeah? And at that time, there was an incredible winter and the sea froze. I'd never seen that before where I live, but the sea froze and there were huge chunks of ice, like 10 meters, some were 10 meters high on the beach. Yeah? And, you know, and it was really something. It looked like Antarctica. And it was just something out of this world. And such, it really made me reflect on the power of nature and what was behind that power. So even as a child, I was thinking, what was behind this world? That's always been my interest, to look behind. And here we are, you know. Still, I want to see behind this world. I want to see Krishna. See this world as a curtain, and let's move it, and behind it we'll see Krishna and his world. That's what really interests me. Now we're old. Okay? Some of us here are of advanced age. Sarvapalma looks like a sage from some forest somewhere. old, wise and old. Or like one of those cartoons, sitting on top of the rock, on top of the mountain, you're climbing up, coming with a question. Yeah, we come up the top and come ask a question. So if you have any questions at the end, you can direct them to either me or to Sarvapalma Prabhu. It's important when we can look behind, when this question is there in our mind, what is behind this world? Because otherwise you get so preoccupied with trying to make it right in this world. You know what I'm saying? It's always like trying to make it right, try to find the right place, try and get the right conditions, try and be with the right people, try and make this world right. But it doesn't really work, you know. Right? I've sometimes said the material world is like an old broken car. And somehow or other, you know, we keep it on the road. But as you fix one side, the screws are falling out on the other side. There's always something broken with a car like that. You know, it just drives, but it's constantly something broken. Yeah. That's life with an old car. Yeah. So the material world also, it's always broken, always. It's fundamentally broken. It will never be fixed. So when we get into this mood of trying to fix the material world, yeah, then all I can say is like, well, good luck. I wish well. Who's you? Are you going to fix the world, or is the world going to fix you? That's the question. Because this material world is a design from Krishna, designed to respond And it's, for me, it's been like a fundamental driving thing throughout my life that has sort of always been me to was looking for virtual reality behind this material reality. And then whatever came on the way came on. Painful. Yes. So whatever came on the way, that's been on the way. Oh, now, since we just got sort of thrown out, but I'm back, Kusum Sarvar before had a hand up with a question. So can we get Kusum Sarvar on the line? I don't see him anymore. But if he's still around... oh Kusum, can you speak, or are you blocked from doing so?
No, everyone can unmute. Okay, well, he has his camera off. I'm not sure.
I don't know where he is, but Kusum Sarva, can you just manifest? That would be great. Otherwise, I'm going to move on. One, two, three. I'm very impatient. That's about the maximum I can wait, 3 seconds. So maybe later when you get it, get it working, and then we'll meet. What to do? If anyone has a question, then it's your time now to put up your hands. Yeah, Roland. I haven't spoken to Roland for ages. That's good.
Roland.
Where are you now?
I'm in the UK at the moment.
You're in the UK, huh? Looking after someone?
Yeah.
Yeah, you're good at that, actually. You're a nice guy, friendly. I guess they like you.
I was wondering if I could ask you about Ekalavya.
Ekalavya.
Okay. And I've often thought about this point, how we hear, even though he was rejected by Jona Acharya, then when they found him in the forest, he was worshipping a murti of Drona. Is that correct? That's what I read in Krishna Dharma's
version.
And he was so expert that he was rivaling Arjuna in archery. So how is it that even though, was it just by practice that he became so expert, or is it even though being rejected by...
Okay, I didn't get it all, but I know what to answer. Ekalavya, it's in a way a tragedy, you know, because Ekalavya was in his own way sincere. Right? He was sort of, he was worshipping the deity of Drona Darya. He became a very, very expert at archery. Then comes that heavy part, you know, where Drona Acharya finds out, and Drona Acharya says, so if you really are my son, then you have to give me dakshi. And then Drona Acharya said, and he says, yes, I'll give you whatever you want. And Drona Acharya said, I want the thumb of your right hand. And by that, you know, he sort of took away his archery, yeah? And it was like very heavy. And if you hear that, you know, you go like, whoa, this Drona Acharya, like, was full on. That was a very heavy act. And how could he do that? Yeah? And it's sort of little bewildered. I don't think I could have very easily asked someone, you know, like I would probably sit by on Ekalavya somehow or other, you know, keep your act together, but you know, don't mess around, okay? But Dronacharya was thinking, no, Ekalavya has not trained. He has not learned the qualities of a kshatriya. A kshatriya is one to protect. A kshatriya is who thoroughly understand balam balavatam chaham, that the strength of the strong is to protect the weak. But Ekalavya has not developed this consciousness and the burden of having such powerful ability in archery, okay, will be exploited. Either he'll exploit it himself, or he will be exploited by others, and he will not have sufficient sense of dharma to stand up. Therefore, Drona Acharya knew that if I allow him to continue with so much skill in archery, he will cause a great disturbance in the world. Therefore, I want that done. So it shows also something about deep, deep gravity in Drona Acharya and how he was thinking very deeply. You know, not slowly, but quickly and deeply. And he deeply understood, you know, deeper than we might understand on the surface. Drona Acharya was looking at the bigger picture. He could see this knowledge of archery is too great a burden for Ekalavya to carry. He doesn't have the dharma. Without dharma, how can he carry such power? No. Arjuna, he has that dharma. Therefore, Arjuna can carry it. Therefore, Arjuna is the chosen one. What do you think of that, old Roland? Poof. Right between the eyes, huh?
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Good to see you, Roland. And yeah, find a balanced way in your life, you know. Go live in Rewake Office. Whenever you are ready to go to Spain, take your time. But when you're ready to go to Spain, live in Rewake and find some work. And in this way, you can maybe, yeah, settle yourself. And then from there, let's see how it will evolve.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. I can't keep up with all this telecommunication. It's too much for me. Emails, WhatsApps, every discussion. I mean, I think if you have nothing to do and you sit in a room all day, you can do that. But try and drive around in a van and do at the same time all this internet stuff. It's just like, woo! So, sorry, I didn't answer your mail, but indirectly, you got the messages, and now I can hear them again.
Thank you.
Adios, amigo. Anybody else? It's Rishi. Rishi, you're a regular questioner.
Oh, Marge, you gave me another name, actually. It's good to see you, Marge. I've been thinking about Vyas Puja, and I wanted to ask if there's any plans or anything in person or online.
There is one plan, and the plan is to make a last-minute maneuver to shake off, to make it small. I don't, nowhere are they ready to handle a big, big thing. If I announce it, then it will become big. Therefore, it will be like a last minute, spontaneous thing wherever I am, you know? And the rest will be online this year. What can we, because the temples are not ready to handle large groups of people.
Mm-hmm.
Like Radhadish just had the mallows, and they had the mallows with about, you know, no more than 100 people all in, you know. That means the singers and the people that came, the technicians and everything. Right? So instead of 1,000. So if I would do a VP, I mean, it's how to limit it, you know, that is the problem.
Mm.
Yeah, would get too big. So I do the same trick like last year.
Gonna have to try and catch you somehow. Okay.
Try and catch me somehow. Catch me if you can.
No, I'll try. Definitely will try.
I'm living in a van. Can't be anywhere on the road.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Oscar. Yeah. Yes, Jani Chandrika from Czech Republic.
Hare Krishna.
Is that where you are right now?
Yeah.
Then?
I'm in my room, in my house.
In your room, in your house. I see. Okay. Tell us.
So previously you mentioned that the material world is basically you will suffer all the time. Oh. And
when did I mention that?
I paraphrased it a little bit.
I see. Sure did. Do you have a parachute? If you suffer all the time, you need a parachute. No? You paraphrased it, but my question is, do you have a parachute?
Actually, yeah, I have 3 in my cupboard.
Yeah, 3 in the cupboard. Then you have nothing to worry about.
So, yeah, is there like any way to... because my point is that you're always trying to find a sort of a perfect situation for yourself. So is there like... any point, any way to tell if it's like a normal amount of suffering or you're really not in a good situation?
Well, it depends, you know, some people can take more than others. So I don't know what's the normal amount of suffering, but I mean, the material world is also some enjoyment. I don't want to make it all so bleak and gloomy, but the enjoyment is just, it's definitely there. But it's never enough to fulfill. I mean, a really good pizza is really good pizza, okay? And you and I know it. And, you know, it takes one to know one. And you and I are amongst those who know what's really good pizza. So that's not the problem. There are good pizzas. There is ice cream also. sometimes, and so on, many good things. But now the point is, that's not enough. Right? Even the best, even if you have the best of pizzas, still not enough. So, and then what? Even a house, beautiful house, still not enough. Even, you know, your dream baby, not enough. Yeah. All these things, it's just not enough. So that's the problem of the material world. It's not always terrible suffering, but in the end, it's just not enough. Anything that we go after, it's just not enough to fulfill us. Still hungry. Still looking. That's material love. So therefore, we look at something deeper, and therefore we look at Krishna, who's behind everything. That's what I was talking about, Krishna behind everything. And that's just like, move the curtain of the material energy aside and see if you can find Krishna.
Oh man,
you're calling for your mother.
No, that wasn't me.
Oh, that wasn't you. Who was that?
Mom. It came from the computer, I think.
Oh, I'm scaring the computer. I'm getting married. I'm trying a bridal outfit.
It's a good look. I like it.
Thank you. Yeah, so what to do? No, in the material world, you know, some of us are not suffering terribly, but we're just not satisfied. So we still need more. And what we have is not bad, but it's also not, yeah, not good enough. And therefore, we need Krishna, but we have to meet him because he's always behind it, hiding behind us. We want to see him.
So, thank you.
Hasta la vista. Yeah. Oh, it's 9 Orion. Gosh, I wouldn't have recognized it. It looks different on the screen.
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
The voice is still the same.
Nice to see you after a while, Maharaj.
Yeah. Yeah. Nice to see you too.
Yes. Maharaj, you were talking a little bit about Vrindavan at the start and your experience and how you sort of felt Prabhupada's presence there so much in the mandir when you arrived. As you know, I was there for a little bit recently. I've made it back to Canberra now. But yeah, I just wanted to get an idea of how you can bring a little bit of Vrindavan with you back home and how you can sort of be in that mood. Even once the I guess the physical trip to Vrindavan Dham's over.
Well, you know, I guess we're building up a relationship with Vrindavan, and we're doing devotional service in Vrindavan. Vrindavan is about devotional service. So whether you're engaging in hearing and chanting, or whether you're doing other service in Vrindavan, it's about service. And service is the is the way to penetrate into Vrindavan. So, well, we went there and we made a connection, and we'll go again and again, and we meditate on Vrindavan while we're not in Vrindavan, and that connection grows deeper, and with it our desire to go to Vrindavan grows deeper. And so it's a lifetime relationship that has to evolve, kind of.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm hoping to go in Kartik, and I'll invite you all. So I hope you can escape from the court.
Yes, Maharaj, I'm hopeful as well.
That'll be good. And then we'll have a great time there.
Indeed. It was
I'd really like to have like a big parikram in Vrindavan this year. Vyasa Puja, I don't really look at, but the Vrindavan parikram, I kind of look at. There's a lot of foreboding that we're going to have a longer period of like low COVID, you know, and everything is going to open up. I can't wait for it.
Yes, we can't wait as well, Maharaj.
when things open up, let's go to Vrindavan. So if I suddenly decide to go for a Dastana to Vrindavan, don't be surprised. Could happen.
Thank you, Maharaj. See you soon, hopefully. Hare Krishna.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna, dear Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances, Jai Shri Prabhupada. I would like to thank you for your very helpful lectures in Malaga. I appreciated them very much. Thank you very much. And I have a question. I've read in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the 11th canto, 18th chapter, verse 6, one should not depend on others for one's personal maintenance, as this will create a debt that can only be repaid by taking another birth in the material world. And for a devotee was mentioned there, every help he accepts is not for himself. Could you explain this, please, for us?
We are, when we do devotional service, then if we take help and we use it in the service of Krishna, then we're not entangled in any way in such karmic networks, because we're taking it simply on behalf of Krishna. So in this way, devotees, they can live off charity, right? Or engage it in the service of Krishna. I mean, if you would start a project for Krishna, you could start a big collection campaign, yeah, for the project. And that would be not entangling you in a new life. You could use it for, if you use it for the project, then it's nice. So we are taking charity from others and engage it in the service of Krishna. That's fine. Then we remain free from entanglement. That's the idea. But for someone who takes it for himself, yeah, then you get involved in these, that you have to repay in the next life. Whatever you take from others. Then we should be careful that we don't take things from others. That we just... Yeah. I'm also a bit careful about what I take from temples. You know, I try not to, so... Is that okay? Not to just take. Okay. I take it.
Thank you very much. Can I ask you about this? You said you was not so earthy. You was not so with the hand in the earth. Do you think that we as devotees have to take care of some earthing, some grounding? I see it from the health side, for me, I'm only not so earthy, but I see it for the digestive tract, or sometimes I have the feeling we need some earthing or some grounding. What is your recommendation to this?
Yeah, I think so. On a personal level, this is for me a struggle because my interest is not there. But yes, I also need some earthing. Earthing also means to care for the body, yeah? Which is something I don't particularly like, but we all have to do. Yeah? It's inevitable. Yeah, we have to do it.
Yeah. Thank you very much. All the best.
So we have to take care of our physical situation, but we cannot expect that the material world will be ever perfect, nor that our health will be perfect. And we can look after our health, but there will always be some imbalance returning, you know, that needs new attention, and something will happen, right? And if it doesn't come from internal, then it comes from external. Yeah, like in my life, a lot of things came from, you know, I got malaria 14 times in a row, you know, and each time 2 weeks knockout. It's too much. Mosquitoes. Now I'm careful about mosquitoes. I like nets. When there's mosquitoes, I want a net. Yeah, I have, actually. I have a mosquito. And in India, whoa, in Africa, I'm careful about mosquitoes. Watch out. Malaria. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Yeah. I've had 42 fever on malaria on Jamastami in Vrindavan, but I didn't die. Too simple. I have to die somewhere outside of Vrindavan. So we take care of the earthly, but to a point, you know. I was in Australia and some were farming and they were like very excited about the size of the cauliflower. And then I had like talking about the biggest cauliflower. And I was thinking like, okay, you know, you have a really big cauliflower and you have one big one and I have two small ones and we have the same subject. You know, what's the big deal, right? Yeah. So I can't get so excited about a big pumpkin or a big cauliflower. Yeah, the big apple for that matter, you know, and all these things are so, the earthly things are for me, I appreciate that we need to exist in the material world, we need to take care, but it can, and so good, but it can never be the goal, you know, if the earthly things becomes the goal, then we are getting stuck in the temporary. The earth is temporary. This physical world is temporary. So I cannot get too much into the temporary world. I have to put my focus on the eternal world. That's the priority. And I will not compromise my relationship with Krishna in the eternal world by acting inappropriately on the earthly plane. Taking what's not mine. Yeah. Then I have to get another birth. Dangerous. All right, some of my thoughts here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oh, Hare Krishna. Yes.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Today, a full pack, whole family.
Yeah. Yes. Nice to see.
My wife is actually always in the background, but the daughter doesn't always allow that to be the focus. So, we actually just wanted to ask you whether you're still going to stay tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, Maradadesh.
Yes, sir.
And is it going somewhere else there after Saturday?
No, but I do have some repairs on the van, and I have to see when I can figure that out. So if I get some appointment in a Werkstatt, then I may suddenly drive the van there, you know. So don't just come for one day, or if you come for one day, you better make an appointment. If you think you drive to Radadesh in the morning and you drive back in the evening back to Wiesbaden or whatever, then you'd better make an appointment with me. But okay. In principle, I'm gonna be a little bit, you know.
Okay, because we were just thinking, we are really looking forward to see you this weekend, but there is some kind of emergency in our temple. There is a Sunday program, and there is no one to make some services, and I don't think that we'll make it this time. That's why I wanted to know if it will be possible. You know, I can work like you know. By traveling, it's anytime. I'm actually really flexible in my.
Well, okay, you know, like in principle, sure, I should be there. Just give me a call if you really want to come on Monday or something. That'd be good.
Okay. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Yes, Hare Krishna. Yeah, cool. Yes, now you are ready.
Hare Krishna. So my question in regards the war at Kurukshetra. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah, war at Kurukshetra.
Yes. So we know that Bhishmadev, he was waiting for the auspicious time for his death, when the sun enters the south hemisphere or something like that, I don't know. And
north.
The north, okay. So I wonder why did they choose the inauspicious time for fighting? Like why they didn't wait for longer? Like we know that for example Duryodhan, he was waiting the whole year. Then he wanted to put into the fire that house of Shela, but then they couldn't wait for some more months or.
Once fighting is like not completely planned. It's a sort of like at one point it's about to and then it just has to happen, you know. I don't know if you have that in your marriage, but I used to have it in mine. Both my former wife and myself, we had strong plans. So sometimes we had Kurukshetra.
Okay, so no time to wait.
When the furniture It's gonna fly.
Okay, thank you. Hi Krishna Maharaj, how are you?
Yeah, I'm okay, and yourself?
I'm all right. So I have two questions. I have had a gift for you sitting on my cupboard for a long time now, waiting for you to come to South Africa. So for Vyasa Puja, are you going to be in Europe still? What do you like me to courier it?
Yeah, sure. If you want to send it around that time, yeah. Yeah, maybe.
You prefer to wait?
No, I mean, you can send it to me today also.
Okay.
I already got to your mother.
Okay, and my other question is, that means that you're going to be missing out on Rath Yatra this year.
There's still no Rath Yatra in Durbs, is it?
We're thinking of having one in Phoenix.
But that's not the real one. The real one is on the beachfront in...
We'll do something at the beachfront. We might do Harinam the next day.
Yeah, okay, that's nice. Hari Namananda is also here. He looks at me and thinks, okay, that sounds already a little better. But not like, wow.
Yeah, maybe not on the same scale as we used to have it before, but at least it's something better than nothing.
Yeah. Now we should eventually bring it to the real scale. Okay.
Mm.
You.
So my other question was that you mentioned how the material world is always broken. And I was just thinking of that in terms of Sri Ishopanishad, the invocation, where it says that everything is complete and perfect. So how do we understand that in such a world where such
broken things happen? It's perfect. Yeah. It's meant to
perfectly
be broken.
Broken?
Perfect. It's just how it's meant to be, broken. It should be unfixable, the material world. That's perfect. That's exactly as Krishna wants it to be. So that we one day come to our senses and say, hey, I don't want to be here anymore. And then Krishna says, yeah, welcome. Please come back. Yeah, that's it. It's perfectly broken. Perfect arrangement.
But the things that happen in this world, they aren't exactly perfect.
Oh, they're all perfect. They're perfect.
Even the bad things?
They're perfectly bad.
Okay.
Yeah.
Didn't think of it that way.
The aim is that the result, the end result is good. It may take a few steps, but ultimately the end result is good. Easy to say. But yeah. Perfect.
Okay. Thank you.
Perfect questions, perfect answers. Okay, and we're running out of time, so let's just quickly two more persons and then we'll come to the end. Yay, Krishnendu.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj.
Good to see you after...
Likewise.
...a long time, yeah.
Yeah. I had a question. You were speaking about hippies and taking certain chemicals, so this was a big part of my life, and it seems like a lot of devotees I've met, it's helped them, you know, seemingly come to Krishna consciousness. I was wondering, you know, how to properly understand that and how to let go of any attachments that may be there, thinking that, you know, these chemicals could help bring realizations or any kind of benefits at all.
Yeah, the chemicals, they gave people a different perspective, right? Where they said, look at the everyday reality from a different angle. That they brought, but at the same time, they also brought people down, like in dependence on the chemicals, and in it to the chemicals, which then pulled them down into a world of chemicals, and that happened to many, isn't it? So there's always been these two sides, you know, but it's clear that many people found that they got some other perspectives by taking such things, substances. Prabhupada was not really making much of it, as we can see. You know, Prabhupada just said, okay, it's not necessary. You can just make that spiritual connection in a sober state of mind. Yeah, I mean, I met someone who went like, wow, everything in the universe is spiritual. Okay, that was a good realization, but he's still working on coming down on the ground, you know, just he got that, but he's still not sober. So we can also see these things in a sober state of mind. Yeah, these maybe in the midst of our ignorance, right? It gave us a temporary kind of insight, but it's just because we're totally lost in ignorance. In so many ways, we were just in ignorance in this world. And if we would have had more knowledge at the earlier stage, we could have saved ourselves so much trouble. If I could have just skipped all those crazy things I have tried, maybe it would have been. I think I could have taken more advantage of the mercy of Krishna consciousness. But in my ignorance, it seemed sometimes enlightenment. But that was because it was in deep, dark ignorance. What we ate, what we did, the values we had, deep, dark ignorance. I never thought of these things, four regulated principles, never thought about them. On my own, I never came. Okay, vegetarian, I could sort of understand a bit, you know. The compassion thing, I mean, that sort of made sense to me. But the rest. What's the big deal? But yeah, if we would have avoided it all, I have some people with me now who were never ever involved in such things, and they didn't miss anything. It's not that they don't get it; they get it. They get it. So now they get it. They get it that everything is real. Spiritual. No, I think in the end, we would have been better off without. Even if in our darkness, it seemed to be shining some light.
Thank you.
Thank you too. Yeah. This was Krishna Indu. And now we've got Tulsi Manjari in a car from Canada, from Quebec.
Hare Krishna.
Or to Montreal.
Oui, non, là, je suis à 1h30 de Montréal, je suis sur la route. Hopefully, the connection will be all right. I'm sorry if I risked to ask a question, even though I'm driving. So.
It still works.
Okay, all right. So, my question is, you know, I'm just reading the ninth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, ninth verse, saying that Lord's saying, that everything rests in him, but he's not part of this, really. Some, I'm paraphrasing. And
Murti.
What is it?
Avyakta Murti, the unmanifested form of the Lord.
And then, but then we know that he's in all the atoms as Paramatma.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the heart of all the living entities.
Yes.
And in the 18th chapter, I think he says, but whoever surrenders unto me, I'm taking care of this devotee, mm-hmm. right? Something like that. I'm paraphrasing again. mm-hmm. But something like that. So could you please elaborate a little more about the subject so yeah. it becomes clearer for me, please?
Yes.
Thank you.
In principle, Krishna is absorbed in his own world. Krishna is so much absorbed in the loving exchanges with his devotees in the spiritual world. That just absorbs him completely. Out of all these devotees in the spiritual world, Srimati Radharani absorbs almost all of his focus. But then he still has so much left for everyone else in the spiritual world. And then, after all that, then there's still something left for all the conditioned souls who are in the material world. For them, he generally makes arrangements through his expansions, right? He expands himself, and in that way, he is sort of, he is free to carry on with his eternal pastimes, but then his expansions deal with the conditioned souls. When the conditioned souls actually take up Krishna consciousness, then Krishna personally takes a little bit of time to also associate with them and give them mercy. But his foremost association is in the spiritual world. Therefore, he's the Avyakta Murti now. He's the unmanifested personality in this material world. And then we hear everything else rests on him. It's more on his energies, on his expansions, and so on. But in his original Swayam Rupa, in his original form, he's engaged in his eternal pleasure pastimes. That's what it means.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you also.
Also, I might just ask if you may give me the chance. Vedavyas Prabhu has written to you back. I might also write you back. About initiation, if you would like,
welcome. What? You are most welcome for initiation. Did he write? Did I get some recommendation letter like from us?
It's well, Vedavyas Prabhu wrote something for that purpose, and I can probably send you another formula from the president of the temple in Montreal if you want.
Yeah, it should be some president or something.
Okay.
That would be good.
Okay.
If you send me that, then it's perfect. Then it'd be
all right. Great.
Yeah.
Me too.
Yeah. And you know, you have, when someone sends me a mail, you better check on me, because I get so much and I just can't handle it, you know, like.
Oh, I totally understand.
And I have an active life, and I don't sit the whole day with playing with my phone as some people do.
I totally understand. I don't have, you know, so many people to connect with, and still I have a hard time to keep it up with all the messages. I don't really like it.
I mean, the whole phone world is a big experiment, and what it does to people, it's incredible. And you know, and if you don't answer somebody's message, my God, it may break the friendship. You know, they may never want to talk to you again. And then, I find out 6 months later that they send me a message. You know.
Yes, ironically, it's technology. It's supposed to be like, how do you say that? Recycling, being faster for communication, but at the same time, it makes us lose so much time. So
Exactly. And it makes people so dependent on communication. Before, you just didn't have communication, and you just go to someone's house, and you weren't sure if they were going to be there, and you just go there, ring the doorbell, and geez, they were not home. Oh my God, what do we do now? Well, just okay, then I'm home, move on, you know?
I mean, yes.
Now it's like, you have to ring, okay. If you walk up at someone's door and you didn't ring, they say, wow, you didn't ring, right? How come you ring? So, and then, please give us a call when you're 5 minutes away, you know? All that stuff, it's just like, and then finally, Haribo, we're in front of the door. The doorbell doesn't work anymore. Right? You just have to call, you know, in front of the door. It's weird. It's weird.
Supposed to make simple, but it's more complicated. It's this material world, right?
Yeah. What to speak of big brothers. Yeah, and what they do with these phones, I mean,
Big Brothers, oh yeah, like Facebook and all,
and other big ones, the big ones.
Yeah, it's they try to control, right? Control everyone
with that. C'est possible, hein?
C'est probablement possible.
Oui. Okay.
Merci.
Merci beaucoup.
Plaisir.
Et on peut parler aussi parfois, hein, quand tu veux.
Ouais. Oui, ok, je vais essayer. Je vais aller rechercher votre numéro de téléphone et tenter de vous rejoindre par WhatsApp, if you want.
Oui, oui, il y aura bien. Ok, allez, bon. Dear devotees, this is it. We thank you for being with us once again. I don't know if Sarvapama is still here, but I thank him for being with us. I appreciate. Ah, you're still there. Yes. Thank you for sticking it out. And we're very, very happy to have you. And I'm looking forward to meeting you. Where are you now, Sarvapama?
Prabhu, you can hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm in Chicago, got back from 10 years in India, and now I'm in Chicago. And I had one quick question.
Ah, please.
So you mentioned, you described how you were with macrobiotic group. Mm-hmm. And it was really kind of funny when you mentioned that you had to sneak in some cheese now and then.
Yeah.
So that brings to mind, there's kind of a controversy existing now between the vegan. There even are, I know there's one temple that's gone vegan. And here up north of me in Wisconsin, I'm in Illinois, north of Illinois is Wisconsin. There is one devotee who has an ahimsa farm where we can get some, not always, but sometimes milk. So I'm just wondering how can we understand to, you know, be encouraged by Prabhupada's example but at the same time, see how to deal with these people that are pushing the vegan idea. There seems to be a bit of a conflict on that.
Yeah, I think so too. I think we're going a bit too far when we go vegan. On the other hand, I do see the urgency of trying to protect the cows, and so that we can also fulfill the need for milk a little bit more ahimsa, right, than just buying it from the supermarket. We just can't manage it right now, you know, to produce all our milk and to protect all these cows, because it's hard to protect cows in this modern world. And we're all just trying to keep head above water for real, right? So it's a little too early to just expect that we're going to be able to have only ahimsa milk. And Prabhupada was clearly wanting us to take milk. So I think we can still take the milk from the cows that are not cared for by devotees. And yes, these cows are not being treated properly, etc., etc. And the etc. is horrible. But okay, for the time being, we use the milk, offer the milk, they get some benefit. And until we as a movement get more established, we may be able to increase the ahimsa milk. Okay? But it is something that is important and that we should really not just, you know, write it off. We should get serious about protecting cows. Right? Absolutely.
Thank you, Maharaj.
So I feel for the devotees who sympathize with the vegan ideal, but I feel a little they take it a little too far. I mean, Prabhupada is Prabhupada, and he was clearly taking milk. What can he do? And yeah, I'm Dutch, you know, so little cheese tends to slip in sometimes.
Thank you very much, Maharaj. The only other thing, I just wanted to thank Jyotamayur Devi Dasi for inviting me to come here. She encouraged me and initially invited me. And I'm very grateful to her, because all your disciples who ask questions, so excellent. Your answers, so wonderful. I really have to thank you very much. Hare Krishna. And
I thank you for your kindness, really, for thinking kind of me. I appreciate it very much.
You're a hero, Prabhu. You're a Mahatma. You definitely are a Mahatma. You're a great soul. Don't get me going here. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Okay. Thank you, Sarva Prabhu, and thank you, everyone else. And see you again next time.